One of the big takeaways is that we all have access to a lot more information of not just who we could be in other realities, but kind of like what's going on with everyone all around us. Physical reality we're watching clearly is a little bit like a simulation itself. It's like a dream. And so these memories that we have collectively, that is the Mandela effect. It's a collective shared memory of things that never happened according to our current version of reality.
What is actually happening in this effect?
That means all these different variations of many worlds are out there.
I'd like to welcome back to the show, returning champion, Cynthia Sue Larson. How are you doing, Cynthia?
Awesome. So good to see you again, Alex.
Thank you so much for coming back.
Always
on
a pleasure.
The show. Yeah, our last conversation was a lot of fun. We went down some deep rabbit holes, which I think we're going to go down a couple of different rabbit holes this time. We might tread on some of the things we talked about before, but go even deeper than we did last time. But one of the things I wanted to talk to you about, last time we were on, we talked a lot about the Mandela effect, about the multiverse, about parallel realities, that kind of stuff. And from your academic background, it's a very interesting conversation. So can you tell everybody who didn't watch our first conversation your background and how you got here?
Background, well, the official background is I've got a degree in physics from UC Berkeley. That's like standard resume stuff. The weirder stuff is that I basically remembered being born, alive before I was born, basically. So it's called born aware. There's a name for that. And then I went through a kundalini awakening. This gets kind of into the weird areas of things. But this is important. It's significant because going through a kundalini awakening, if people don't know what that is, it involves just feeling energy rushing through the body, specifically through what are known as chakras, which may not even make sense when it's happening. It's sort of a mind-blowing experience. It was for me. So I was in my early 30s, and that was the moment when my old vision of reality and the way things worked was just thrown out the window. And I recognized it's possible to instantly be remote viewing something and knowing something that there's no way that I should be able to know that. So it sort of ripped apart the foundation of classical physics presets and assumptions. So from a quantum physics perspective, that would make more sense. So those are some big things that happened along the way for me. I've had lots of other weird experiences.
When you had your awakening and you're in a kundalini awakening, were you in school or was this already passed after you had your physics degree?
Yeah, fortunately, I was out of school, finished the physics program. I also got an MBA degree. So finished that. I was in my 30s, so I'd actually kind of taken a break from my corporate job, which I'd worked at for 7 years as a project manager, working with information technology, computers, projects for a huge banking corporation. But I'd quit that for a short time, taking a short-term leave of absence to be a stay-at-home mom. And so I was a stay-at-home mom of a couple of young kids when this happened. And that was kind of a weird time to have it happen, but that's when it happened. I was ready. And I think these things are intuitively perfectly timed. When you look back at your life, it all makes sense. In the moment, it just seems like, wow, this is crazy.
So one thing that we really didn't touch on last time we spoke is quantum jumping and the idea of quantum jumping, because can you explain to people what quantum jumping is? Because when I discovered quantum jumping, I was like absolutely fascinated with this idea of what we can do with quantum jumping. So can you explain to people in layman's terms, what is quantum jumping?
Okay. Some laymen are familiar with timelines. So I'm going to start there, because if you feel like, okay, in one timeline, I am starting to catch a cold, in another timeline, I'm perfectly healthy. So I feel like I'm kind of in the sick one, but I know I can do it. I'm just going to quantum jump to that timeline where I'm not sick, and recognizing it is another parallel possible reality. By virtue of being identified with my consciousness, I should be able to do this, given focus, enough energy, and just acting as if I've done it, basically. And so that's, in a nutshell, what it feels and looks like for a layman who understands timelines.
So, and I think anyone who's watched the Marvel movie in the last decade understands timelines in the multiverse and things like that. These are ideas that are really starting to come into the zeitgeist in a big, big way, which before they were just talked about in academia or a weirdo geek, comic book geek somewhere in a dark corner at a party or something like that would bring these ideas up. But the idea of quantum jumping that I came across is the ability to jump to different parallel versions of yourself and learn the skills of that person. So if, like, let's say there's a parallel life where you and I are both billionaires, let's
Yes.
say,
Yes.
and there's parallel lives where you and I are both holy men and women, you know, who are preaching the good word, let's say. And if we wanted to jump to either one of those versions of ourselves, we can, I guess, contact them. How do you actually? So let's say I'm going to put it, for instance. So I want to
Right.
go, and I'm like, man, you know, I can't get this podcast off the ground. There's got to be a version of me somewhere who is a master at media, master of technology, and is very successful in this arena. And I let's say in my And this is where you lose me. So I want, hopefully you could
Okay.
help me with this. How do I then connect with Alex, the amazing media mogul podcaster, you know, and master of all media in another timeline so I can pick his brain about how I can bring it into this timeline? How do you go about that?
Yeah, me personally, the way I've done it is feeling like there's that connection already happening. First of all, knowing it's possible. So it's really great that people are watching these movies about superheroes and everything everywhere all at once shows that the concept as well. So there's some good films out there. So knowing it's possible helps. When I've done this, then I've almost always felt compelled. I felt this, it's almost like I was that other personality and feeling frustrated. When I was working at the large financial corporation, it was Citibank. I didn't have legal training, but we were, well, I was not going to a meeting, but my superiors were all in some meeting talking about how to do a merger with another corporation. And I thought, well, we just need this document. And then some version of me that had legal training, apparently, crafted a legal document because I felt like I compelled. I felt like I need this. I need to know this. I was going to do it. And so I just put together a legal document, which wasn't necessarily the final one, but it kind of blew the minds of the people that were looking at it, like, where'd this come from? And that was just one of many times. Another time I felt that it was that feeling, that rush of energy is how I personally know. And it's of any kind of quantum jump, even a miraculous one where I've walked through a locked door. If I got the rush of energy, then I know I'm connected with the other reality where I'm pulling in that information or that ability to do whatever it is that I'm thinking I'd like to be able to do that. Another time I jumped up on stage and played the drums when the drummer had walked off from a group that was performing. It was just a small thing. It wasn't like a huge thing. Maybe there were 20 people in the audience and the drummer, I don't know why he left, maybe needed to use the bathroom, but he left, walked right off in the middle of the song. And I don't play that. I did not play the drums before that. What happened is I felt this rush of energy and a knowingness. My arms wanted, they craved to play those drums. I needed it. And it overcame my shyness and embarrassment and all feeling of what am I doing? Like, I don't know the drums. I'm like, yeah, you're going to get up, so you're going to play this. I just felt like I could do it. I'm going to. So for me personally, it's when I'm thinking like, yeah, that would be cool. And then it becomes not just an idea of that would be cool, but it's an embodied feeling. Like I need to write a legal document. I need to play the drums. I just feel like I'm not just acting as if I know I can do it. And that's what I did. I went up on stage and played the drums for that whole rest of the song and then the next song or two. Very strange. And I guess it didn't suck. They would have said,
I think thinking about it, sometimes that happens to me every once in a while, especially when I'm talking to a physicist or a polymath or a geologist or a neurosurgeon, and I will start having conversations with them on the show, and then all of a sudden I will start talking to them at their level. I'm not by any stretch saying that I am a physicist by any stretch. But certain concepts, I can talk at their level or at least break it down in a way that others understand it. And it's fascinated me because I failed math in high school. So
Oh my gosh.
So, like, math is not my strong suit, but I'm standing there with a polymath talking to me about the different structural, the different engineering math that is needed to build the pyramids and what's embedded inside of the pyramid and its height and its width and what that means to the astrology or the astronomy and all this kind of stuff. And I'm holding my own. So it's
Nice.
I tell my wife, I'm like, how am I doing? Like, I really don't understand how I'm doing this because these are concepts that were so like if you talk to me about quantum physics, I could have a fairly educated conversation. I can't get into the math with you, but I could at least hold my own on certain concepts and ideas that would have never in a million years made any sense to me. So maybe I'm doing it subconsciously. I have no idea.
That's actually a big part of it. We subconsciously access this. I know that's got to be true. I was reading a book recently that's gone into the public domain called Operators and Things. It's about a woman's descent into schizophrenia, and then she came back out 6 months later. Obviously, before she went, fell into schizophrenia, she was a, I think, a professional observer because she was observing her mind. To her, it didn't seem like she was crazy. She just started noticing people that were showed up as hook operators telling her things. I'm going to skip the schizophrenic part. People may think that's weird. Yeah, it's weird. But the cool part is during the 6 months where she quit her job following the advice of these beings that showed up, but they were her subconscious, is how she interpreted it later. She was able to go gambling and win all the money she needed to live on for 6 months. Her subconscious, she feels, also gave her the ability to, write letters at the right moment to somebody who then, upon opening the letter, would just talk to someone who, like, "Hey, you're hearing from Barbara O'Brien? Great, I owe her money. Where's she living?" And the friend's like, "Well, that's funny. That's all she gave me was her address. Well, this is not much of a letter. It's just her address." And then the friend's like, "Cool, can I have that?"
We are in a time of great change, and humanity is awakening more and more every day. Mankind needs insights on what is happening to all of us. That is why I'm inviting you to Wisdom from Beyond, a 6-day virtual summit designed to awaken your soul. Experience over 9 hours of soul-expanding channeling sessions led by 6 of the world's most esteemed channelers. Connect with the divine, receive sacred insights, and transform your journey by asking questions directly to the channelers themselves. This is more than just a summit. It is your gateway to understanding the profound shifts happening within and around all of us. Plus, when you sign up, you receive exclusive bonus content to deepen your spiritual exploration. Join us and step into the extraordinary.
And so somehow was accessing this level of conscious agency that we're all connected to. And to me, this is where it starts getting interesting. So in the book, Operators and Things, there's a lot interesting about that book. It's a classic. But one of the big takeaways is that we all have access to a lot more information of not just who we could be in other realities, but kind of like what's going on with everyone all around us. And you can think of it as multidimensional. Because if you're talking about math, if you look at like flat land with two dimensions and a flat piece of paper, yeah, my
I
favorite
love
way
that
to look
book.
at this whole, when you look at like reality shifting, quantum jumping, the key to it is knowing that we're multidimensional. And just like you can look at a flat piece of paper, and if people are, if the characters, the circles and squares and dots and lines, if they're playing hide and go seek, you can just be looking down from your three dimensions of space. It's easy to see where Mr. Circle or Mr. Square are hiding, like, oh, they're in the closet. It's just like the diagram of a house. But if you say that to the people who are down there, they'll be like, how did you do that? And that's like us knowing how to just win when you're gambling or get the money you need. I'm not advocating gambling, but if you need the money and you know it can just show up, it will. And that is definitely quantum jumping.
Does meditation have a part to play in quantum jumping?
It absolutely does, because it's going to provide both the ability to relax and not be kind of locking in what we assume to be the reality around us. You need to be able to relax and kind of get in a Zen state of flow. Meditation assists with that, because when you're thinking about the quantum nature of reality, that it could be a particle or it could be a wave function, you want to get it into that nice blissed out wave function state. We can do that through meditation. You can just get to where like in a fixed state. I don't have enough money. I've got a crisis. There's a storm coming. And you just get into your meditation state, and it all just gets like, oh, all these things are possible. Who knows what it's going to be? So meditation instantly can drop you down into that, can help you ground and help you access. When you come back into your regular state of consciousness, you've accessed a new reality. You've locked in a different physical point. And that meditation both relaxes and sort of releases whatever that tight grip is on one particular reality, and also allows you to feel energized, hopefully. A lot of people feel energized after a good meditation, like a good night's sleep.
Very much so. Very much so. Now, you did mention something in regards to reality shifting. There is a channel that we've spoken to on the show. His name is Daryl Anka, who talks about that we are constantly shifting realities throughout the day. At any
Yes.
at every second, almost every second, every day, you're moving into
Yes.
different realities and shifting into different
Yes.
versions of yourself. So
Right.
there's a version of me that did not do this podcast and is
Right.
and went off and is in a miserable space right now. Poor, I feel bad for that version of him. And there's one that did not open up an olive oil and vinegar gourmet shop in LA years ago. Biggest mistake I ever made. But there's another one that he's like, no, you know what? We're just gonna skip that and move along. Can you explain reality shifting? Because it sounds, I can wrap my head around it, but
Yeah.
the realities are
Yeah.
infinite. The timelines are infinite, to my understanding. So how do you shift in between realities, not only on a personal standpoint, but then we'll get into the macro. So the micro, but then also the macro of shifting. And then we'll get into the Mandela effect, which is my favorite thing to talk about. But go ahead.
Yes. Okay, reality shifting is where my entrance onto this whole stage of mind matter interaction, because that's where I walked in. I recognized things are changing, reality shifting, and I got all excited about it. Like, is anyone else noticing this? Stuff's changing. I'll put my keys down and they're not where I thought they were. Like, stuff's changing all the time. Dudes, is anyone else noticing? This is back in the 1990s. A lot of people didn't really notice it. It wasn't a big thing back then. I did start a book. My agent had no interest in it. And then What the Bleep Do We Know came out. Anyway, I'm showing her, look, this stuff's, people are noticing this. But anyway, I independently published my first book, Reality Shift, started the website, realityshifters.com, started firsthand report collection of people's sharing their stories from around the world. So what this is, what you might wonder, what the heck is it? I've described it as anything where you notice, it's kind of like you're noticing, like you're walking between these worlds, like exactly like what Daryl said. So you're just walking, and 1 minute you're in one reality, the next you're in another. That means that things can look like they're changing. Things can appear, disappear, transform, transport. You can have changes in time, slowing down, all that stuff happens, and loops of time. And so I've been deeply intrigued by this whole phenomenon. So when I talked about reality shifting and collective stories, it's sort of that accidental reality shifting, like, whoa, what just happened here? Not noticing that the subconscious is indeed running that show, and that when you're moving between these realities, it's kind of like when you're, we're sort of like this connected set of conscious agents. We've got our neurons in the head, neurons in the heart, neurons in the gut. The gut is going to give us what we need, and it runs the show because we always get what we need. Sometimes when the head and heart get pulled along, then they notice, wait, where are we? And so if you're not all lined up through the meditation process or conscious, reality shifting, which is what I tend to call quantum jumping, then you don't know that such things are possible. So it's all connected. Reality shifting is something we're naturally doing it. And that's why I call it realityshifters.com. We're all reality shifters. That's the big secret. It's happening all the time. I totally agree. Now, getting people that are normal, people who don't watch your show, to understand and appreciate this, that's going to be a tough sell, because it's going to be hard for people to say, like, I don't think I'm shifting. They might not notice it, but the more you pay attention to it, the more you're going to start noticing it, and then you can start having some fun with it. You can reality shift to experience some of the things that you need, but you also love, and you also can visualize. So it's possible to start fine-tuning that process.
So where is it that, how does it work with reality shifting when like let's say me and my family, we seem to be shifting together, meaning that we both, you know, I walk out my door and there's my family, as opposed to walking out the door like, where'd my family go? I'm not married anymore. What is happening? Have I shifted that? That I haven't heard of or seen of, at least. But how does it work with other individuals shifting the same realities as you are shifting?
Yeah, this is where I like the quantum physics concepts, because they make, to me, it helps me hold on to ideas like, oh, obviously it's working, because obviously the family is entangled with one another. We share connections.
Entangled.
We're like a flock of birds. Yeah. Like, why is a flock of birds flying together? They're entangled. And they act like a quantum liquid, like a quantum, you know, state. Like, these beings are all entangled with one another. And we can be entangled too. We often are with our friends, even if we don't see them all the time. You might make a similar quantum jump or a reality shift with those that you're entangled with that you love very much, because you talk and you have that heartfelt connection. So even if you're not talking to them regularly, they might make a shift with you. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't, and then you'll have different memories of, you know, what happened a few years ago.
Would it make sense that, so this has happened to me. I've had old friends all of a sudden reach out to me. They're like, what happened to you? Like, you used to be a filmmaker. Now you're a spiritual podcaster, and you've got, how many people are following you? And you, what, how, like, it's completely a good, it's just, and I understand I'm in a completely different universe than I was 4 years ago, 3 years ago. I mean, seriously, it was like a completely different version of myself, of where I am today. And there's a shift that happened. There's no question. And the shift seems to be getting farther and farther away from, I'm leaving the old version of me behind, and there's this new version of me moving forward. But looking at it from the perspective of friends, they just like, I haven't looked you up in 3 years, 4 years. And what happened? Is that just that I moved on and they are stuck in their old timeline? Or we're just not connected, entangled, if you will. So they really didn't see it. And to them, it's a complete, you know, a complete shock. You know, does that make sense?
Yeah, it does make sense. And yes, it could be a complete shock. It could be for them, like, what the heck, man? Like, just a second ago, I swear, you were doing filmmaking and you were still doing that like last month. I would say, I know that's going to sound crazy to you from your point of view. Well, fortunately, you're doing these interviews and you're talking to Rich Beshar and me and people like that. Rizwan Burk too. So you're talking to people about these ideas. And so for you, it's like, you can accommodate that concept, that for your friend, that really was that shocking. Just like literally a month ago, maybe your friend might swear for sure up and down, like, absolutely, you were still doing filmmaking. And in that reality, it's possible. So I advocate be understanding when people say things like that, because it's possible that you could both be right from his subjective reality. It's like a very specific version of reality that your friends are experiencing. And some of them may have somewhere they're not sure, or like, oh, okay, so you switched to 4 years ago. Okay, wow, that's a big change. So it could be a variety of experiences for different people, and they're all perfectly fine. Any of them are possible. And I think the ones that are going to experience the biggest shifts, they're more ready at some level to start understanding these big ideas, like the ones you're talking about on your podcast, which is really cool. So the ones who are like, whoa, they're pretty much ready for your material.
Whether they like it or not, in many ways. So as we continue to go down these lovely rabbit holes of quantum physics and parallel realities and quantum jumping and these kind of ideas, what does this mean for us spiritually on our soul's journey in this life? Because a lot of times these conversations get really into the geek, and that's awesome. And I'm a geek myself. But for people watching who, like, this is all nice and dandy, but what does this mean for the evolution of our soul? How is it affecting this reality? So this version of me, if I all of a sudden start to shift over to the media mogul side or the astronaut side, or the, you know, I think I'm just going to start learning quantum physics and I get a PhD in quantum physics or something like that. What does that mean for this reality in our soul's journey? Or is all of those realities this soul's journey? This is when it's going to start getting a little heady. all these thousands and thousands of versions of this Alex, of Alex. Not, we're not talking past lives or future lives. We're talking about this life or this incarnation of me in this time period, but infinite versions of myself. So I'm exploring infinite ways of what this avatar can do. You know, in one avatar, I'm in the military, and another one, I'm an astronaut, another, and it, but all within this player in the game, as opposed to the Roman soldier, the guy who lived in Rome, the guy who lived in, or the gal who lived in the pyramids, you know, in Greece, that stuff. So what does this have to do with all of that? I know I threw a thousand things at you, so.
That's a big question about what's going on with all these other possible versions of me and versions of you. And are we learning from it? Absolutely, we're learning from it. We can also, I choose to prune mine like a bonsai tree personally, to better invest the resources that I've got access to at my aggregate level of me-ness. So the mm-hmm. being that I am, I just make choices to prune out any kind of negatively impacted or impacting versions of myself that would be going down kind of a dead end of some sort or another. It might be, you know, just too lazy or too hurtful or mean spirited, anything that would be causing damage to myself or others. I'm just pruning those right out, both in the past and the future. And then the sort of present moment kind of going along. Now, but that's something I'm personally choosing to do. And I'm mentioning it because a lot of people feel like that's their big stumbling block on this whole idea. When you mention this idea, a lot of people, they get bit bug-eyed. They're like, oh no, I don't want a version of me that's out there killing people as a serial murderer. And so I'm just putting that right front and center. You can prune that. You can say, like, I'm not going to experience every single thing. The things I've already learned that I don't need to do, I can just clean those out. That leaves me then with all the best possible realities that I would like to experience. So I'm kind of covering a basic thing here, but it's part of how good can it get, and also removing interference possibilities, which is a very big deal. If we don't do it, then what happens with the subconscious? It wants to explore it. It's like a little kid, like, don't go in that cupboard. And you know where that two-year-old's going to go next. It's like, why did you say don't go in that cupboard? They're going to go right into that cupboard. So by recognizing that all the possibilities are there, therefore, let's find what I would personally like to experience are the ones that I feel like I need to learn from the most. The ones I've already learned from, what I call dead ends. Like, I know not to be hurting other people, injuring them in any way, because I feel like I've been through enough lifetimes to learn that. So let's just nip that in the bud and trim off those branches of the possibility tree where that could be happening. So it's a very spiritual process.
So and, as far as, let me ask you this, because as you were saying this, images started flying into my head, apparently from another version of myself, that I the image that kind of came into my head as you were talking is this, like, one soul in the middle and literally infinite versions of him or her floating around. And as we are living our life, those multiple versions, when you were saying that, well, you don't have, in this lifetime, you might not have a version of a reality where you're a serial killer, let's say, because you might have already gone through that in other lifetimes. So not every lifetime is going to have every possibility, because you're not going to explore things you've already explored. Very similar to a video game. You're not going to go down levels that you've already yeah. won. So why would you do it again in this other version of you? It doesn't make sense. So those things start to peel away. But this is the interesting part, and I'd love to hear what you think about it. As we evolve and our frequency rises, as we're starting to get closer and closer to source, as we're starting to evolve towards enlightenment, towards true self-realization, these other lives and other realities start to fall away, to the point where you're starting to prune and prune and prune till you get to a point where there is only one reality, and that is the point where you've learned everything you needed to learn and you have found enlightenment. And that's when you become a master, a walking master, then to transform into an ascended master, very much like a Jesus Christ, very much like a Buddha, very much like a Yogananda and many other ascended masters. Does that make sense to you? This is just an idea I came up with. So does that make sense from one of my other versions?
I like it. I feel like I'm not close to that one, and I can tell why not. If you're wondering, well, how would you know where you are? Oh, I'm not close to that. I love it. Oh, yeah. I think it's so possible. But the reason I personally feel like I'm not quite there yet is because
Sure.
I'll wake up feeling like this is a whole new version of me. I'll have an excitement about the day. Like it's like, oh, I'll feel like, oh, you, this version of you hasn't been here before. Like, what? And so it's like, man, there must be a lot of versions of me. Because it's like I'm cycling through and it's each little facet feels new. I'm mentioning that part. If people are like, how close am I? Well, if that's the thing is still happening, then there's a ways to go, but that's a good thing. There's a ways to go anyway. But yeah, it
Most of
totally
us don't
makes
find an
sense.
yeah, most of us don't find enlightenment in this life. In generally speaking, we're still learning here. You know, we don't get the PhD right away. Go ahead.
I love to end with, the way some of these stories in Buddhism end, and then they were all enlightened, which I think is so beautiful. So I love that idea, like we're headed that way. That's where we're going. But along the way, people feel like I'm not done yet. I want to investigate, I want to explore. And that's what's fun about this reality, is all the opportunities to try out all these different things. And if you're not having fun, maybe you're not doing it right. It's like, okay, slow down. Stand back, watch more of your shows and get the idea. Like you said, this is like a game where we're both playing it, and we're the player and the game piece for both, the behind the scenes operator who's
The
deciding,
player
like,
and the
okay,
avatar, the player and the avatar at the same time.
yes, right.
So the concept of deja vu then really starts to play a factor in these parallel realities, because kind of like I always bring up the Matrix. I know you love the Matrix as well. The idea of the glitch where the cat walks back again. They're like, "What's that?" He goes, "Oh, there's been a shift in the matrix. In the Matrix, that means something has changed." And then they open the window and there's bricks there. It's because the computer's changed the matrix. But that's kind of like a visual representation of change in the matrix. So when we have deja vu, is that just us remembering another version of ourselves, or are we kind of jumping to the future? They're like, "I feel like I've been here before." We've all felt that. We've all walked into a room. We've all had a conversation. Like, I swear to God, we've had this conversation. Sometimes it's so clear that you know what the other person's going to say before they say it. Or something's, oh, that phone. Ooh, and a lot of times the phone rings and you know who it is. These kind of things that, but deja vu specifically, feeling the room or feeling a situation, is that part of this reality shifting?
Yeah, it does definitely factor into it in the sense that it's then possible to sometimes literally notice. I've actually seen people do things more than once in a physical space. It's only happened a couple of times, but that was enough to be quite shocking that it's much more than just deja vu. Deja vu is pretty amazing in itself. So I hate to say just deja vu, but I've literally seen with witnesses a woman walk into a hotel lobby twice, doing the same thing, wearing the same clothes with the same attitude and demeanor. She was just walking through the room looking elegant. It was a nice hotel. And there was a woman I was talking to. And the second time the woman came again through from the parking lot through the lobby, I turned to my friend and I said, did you see her just a minute ago too? And she did. And so I stopped the woman who was walking through and asked, did you already walk through here? Or do you have a twin who was dressed exactly like you? She said, no. It must have seemed like a weird question. But these things can actually physically repeat also, which is wild. And so this is how it ties in. If you're wondering, where's the tie-in? Because the physical reality we're watching clearly is a little bit like a simulation itself. It's like a dream. And so that's the connection. And then the access that we have via knowing that we are the player, as you call it, or a higher level of conscious agency, we're capable of seeing all of the avatars or possible versions of ourselves that are doing all these things. And time, it's not the linear time that we tend to assume it is when we're in our eternal, infinite conscious version of ourselves, the one that's enlightened. We've got access to everything. At that level, we have full dimensional access to all the keys, all the codes, all the realities, and we know what they all are. Sometimes at that level, we're apparently sharing that information with those of us who are down here, boots on the ground, the avatar. So we're getting the little run through of the deja vu before it happens. And then it's like, what happened? It's all repeating.
Now, when I, because I love, I'm so glad you're on the show, because I don't get to have these conversations very often to go down some deep rabbit holes. We're about to jump into a very deep one. which is this concept. It was a spiritual concept that was taught to me by many near-death experiencers, many mystics, yogis who've been on the show. And when I bring this idea up, no one even blinks. Everyone goes, oh, yeah, absolutely. Because they're seeing it from their perspective or where they have been or where they can go to. But our little 5-inch floppy that is our brain, it's extremely difficult to process. The idea is that we have this life, but there is no real time. So there is no technical past life. There's no technical future life. All lives are happening at the exact same time as we would look at it. So it's happening instantaneously. So right now, you and I are in Greece, in ancient Greece. You and I are in Atlantis. You and I are in the Great Pyramid while it's being built. You and I, like these multiple incarnations that we as a soul have decided to incarnate as, are all happening at the same time. And if you want to get a little bit more heady, they're not all on Earth, but we could go down that road later. there's a large universe out there. So they're not all on Earth. And that's another conversation. But how can you wrap your head and explain this idea of not only are we living just one life multiple times all around, like, you know, all those different, but then infinite versions of those that we want to explore in those avatars. So all of the parallel realities in Rome, all the parallel reality in China, ancient China, all the parallel reality in Atlantis, and so on. It's so mind-boggling. It's almost the infinite nature of the universe, which is also extremely mind-boggling. So how would you explain that to people?
That's like being inside the mind of the absolute, the mind of God. It's like accessing that eternal infinite. And at that level, of course, we can access all of that. For those of us who do have past life memories, I've got a past life memory from the future, from a possible future that I hope never occurs. But that one, it's like when we have one of those, it's like it's almost like a movie. Like for me, it's like I remember how it started, where it went, and how it ended up. And it's like it has a linear component to it. That's why. So when we, for those of us who access these things, we tend to think like movies or like a book, like it's. It goes through this whole sort of a process. So it's mind blowing for us to then contemplate, well, wait a minute, if that was happening, how could I also be in all these other times and places? That's where the mind goes tilt. And that's the key to it, is just accessing the infinite eternal quality of what it feels like for me is when I collapse things down to no thought. So if I want to experience what we're talking about, then I just follow my thoughts, and I keep slowing them down. So there's hardly any thoughts, and they're just getting slower and slower. When it feels like I'm stopping time, what I then next experience is it's like an entry into that absolute eternity. But it might take like 20 minutes of holding my thoughts stopped before it happens. So you have to be really patient. And if people want to experience this, practice a lot, it helps. And if it starts feeling like this is not for me, then don't do it. It's not for everyone. but then when you go into that, it's super cool, because then you can start experiencing, and I don't know how to put words around it. I don't know how to describe what it feels like when you're there. And of course, everything's happening all at once, but there's no rush and there's no concern. It's just that feeling, it's that wonderful feeling you get when you're with the absolute and all the questions are answered. And then you come back into regular life. People ask you, well, how do you explain this? And you can't find the words. So I don't really have the words to explain it, but it does feel like a dimensional trick. If you wonder, oh, is this done? That's a dimensional trick. And it is accessing that mind of oneness, the mind of the eternal, infinite absolute.
For me, it makes me feel more comfortable knowing that this is all happening at once, that there are infinite versions of myself, not only in this incarnation, but multiple incarnations or infinite incarnations across the infinity of the universe, which is, this conversation alone is very complex for some people, without question. But then you throw in there's other planets on the universe that can support life. That's just logic at this point. And, there's things that we could do on other planets that we couldn't do on this planet. you know, different environments, different, you know, a war-like planet, though I think this is that war, that planet, or a peaceful planet or a more evolved planet that you can want to do other things, or a less evolved planet, which we could do other experiences and so on. It makes me feel more comfortable. I don't know if that makes any sense to you, but it makes me feel less alone. That I'm like, oh, there's infinite versions of Alex out there hustling and doing his thing and trying to make things happen. And it just makes me feel, I don't know why, it just makes me feel like I wish we could get all together and have a conversation. Maybe that's a movie. I don't know.
Yeah, I find it reassuring as well. And I like to think of this planet as its best possible version of itself. I like to think of us, we humans, as Homo sapiens, wise humans. I like to call us into our greatness, because when we do that, then we can experience that. And we don't need to constantly be dwelling and fixating on what's wrong and all the issues that hopefully one would hope we could learn from, because I know we
Yeah.
will. We can, we are. And that sense of joy you're feeling is such a good one, just to know, like, all those versions of us, all these best possible versions of us, they're out there, you know, helping all the people that you wish you could help, but there's only one of you. But there isn't just one of you. There are all these versions of you, capable of being everywhere you need to be, capable of saying just the right thing, to touch someone's heart, cheer them up, give them hope, help them think of just the right thing to do to break through a stuck point. And you're doing that. I mean, you're doing it with your show, but the more you know that all those versions of you are out there, the more you can experience the joy of that too. And so it does feel good.
Did you ever see a movie called The One with Jet Li?
I think I have seen that a while ago. Yes.
It was a long, it was a movie about he, there was an evil version of him in a parallel reality. And there was a machine that he could go to different realities. And he was, that bad version of him was literally killing off all of his other versions of himself and other parallel realities. A fascinating story, where then he had to battle this one version to be the one, the only version, because he had killed all the other versions of himself. It's fascinating, beautiful sci-fi, you know, great kung fu action and everything. But I just remember that. I was like, it's in the zeitgeist. This is coming up.
Yes.
These ideas are being brought, are being birthed in this reality, which years ago, people would have just looked at you like, you're out of your mind. Out of your mind. But now people are really open to these ideas.
You asked earlier why it's happening. Now we need it right now. I mean, this is the time clearly that we need to know we're not just the avatar, like we're the player and the avatar. We're operating these different levels of conscious agency. And like that movie suggests, I think that was sort of almost a worst case scenario, or it sure brought up the nightmare factor, that one.
Yeah.
Like, oh my gosh. I'd forgotten about that, but it's kind of spooky when there's like the evil one, of course, being the serial murderer, and like, I'm going to kill off all the other good selves. Like, oh no.
To be the one, well, I mean, Dr. Strange in the multiverse, he had to fight his evil version of himself, which is as powerful and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, there is, you know, and it's, and then when you start thinking about your doppelganger out there who might not be as nice as you, maybe he is the killer. Maybe he is the evil one. And thinking about that, if you want to deal with that in this incarnation, maybe you've already felt, maybe you were Genghis Khan in another, you know, in another lifetime, or Alexander the Great. You've dealt with a lot of killing and war. You don't want to deal with it now. But it's a fascinating, you know, I'm a filmmaker by heart, so I think about these stories, and it just really opens up a lot of can of worms. Now, we've been talking about parallel realities. Is there a difference between parallel realities and the multiverse?
Yeah, the parallel realities and the multiverse. You could say, well, the correct answer to your question is yes, there's a difference. And if you want to get, then we could get really technical and go into,
let's go for
like,
it.
how
Let's
many
go down.
Variations? We'll do some summarized version of going down into that,
because
it gets kind of gnarly and technical. Because there's so many different versions of the many worlds interpretation of quantum physics is where I'm going with it. So if you start with, like, Hugh Everett III came up with, oh, many worlds interpretation. So there can be a multiverse. Well, as soon as the multiverse can of ideas opened, I was going to say worms, but it's like, it's a can of multiverses. Then there are all these different flavors and varieties and versions of them. And within quantum mechanics and quantum physics, we don't yet have an agreed upon singular quantum interpretation that is the one that everyone agrees to. So that means all these different variations of many worlds are out there, different quantum possibilities. I think there's a difference in the sense that it depends on which version of it you're talking about. So that's the technical answer. But to the layman, it's pretty darn similar.
Yeah, I was about to say, it's like, yeah, let's say there's a billion Earths or infinite amount of Earths. Well, there would have to be if I had an infinite amount of realities on this planet, right? So it seemed pretty similar, essentially, to a layman at least.
For the layman, sure. I think the quibbling happens with some of the unaddressed issues in physics, which have to do with who is the observer and definitions of terms. So when you get into the clear delineation and definition of the terminology, then that's where all this little scuffling happens, like what's real and what's physical and what can we, you know, the measurables can be measured, but the measurement process is there's already sort of the complication there, because if there's someone observing the system, then it's not within the system you're observing. And that's one way to take a look at that little problem. But there are all kinds of issues and problems, which to me occur at just the very limited version of mathematics that we're working with. So we're going to need to go to a better construct that handles putting together the quantum realm plus the astronomical, you know, the super big scale of relativistic, the universe, the cosmos, and something that can handle all of that might be along the lines of something like the amplitudehedron. So that would be a new kind of mathematics. So then you could say, I never needed to learn this old math anyway. I'll just move on to the new math. Maybe that's what you're waiting for. I think when you see the right math, you might feel like, this is what I've been waiting for. This is easy. It makes sense. No, but going back to the quantum universes, the multiverse, it's pretty similar for a layman. I think there's no need to get all caught up in which, you know, who is the observer. Yeah.
So my favorite, now we're going to talk about my favorite topic, which is the Mandela Effect, which is your new book, The Mandela Effect and Its Society. For everybody who has not heard about the Mandela Effect, can you just tell people why it's called the Mandela Effect and what is the Mandela Effect?
Okay. It is called the Mandela Effect, named after Nelson Mandela, who some people remember died. He died, as they recall, back in 1987 on Robben's Island, where he was incarcerated. He was put in jail for being speaking up and saying things that were you know, antithetical to the current government at the time. However, we know from looking at history that Nelson Mandela did not die in jail, because he went on to become president of South Africa. And I remember that. But weirdly, it's like, this is where it starts getting interesting, when people notice, like, wait a minute, he was president, but I sort of remember he died too. And I remember some details about what happened when he died in jail. Because some people may remember that there was tussle, some fighting over his estate with his wife, Winnie. And people remember, yeah. And then the sort of people were trying to do peaceful vigils to honor his life, but there was some upset and there was stress and like scuffling around that. But none of that happens now. And so these memories that we have, collectively, that is the Mandela Effect. It's a collective shared memory of things that never happened according to our current version of reality. And so what does that feel like? For me, I remember I used to watch the Disney movie on Sundays, and there'd be Tinkerbell coming out at the beginning of the Disney presentation. She'd usually have a
wonderful,
wand.
It's called The Wonderful World of Disney.
Yes, exactly. Yes. And she'd have her little wand and she'd go ting, bing. And then with like really sparkles and twinkles. And it was in front of the magic castle, and she puts a dot on the eye. Well, that never happened.
Stop it. No. That's a new one. I haven't heard that one before. Are you serious? The Wonderful World of Disney did not exist, or that animation doesn't exist?
Tinkerbell did not do that ever.
Of course she did. I'm looking at it in my head right now. I'm literally playing that scene in my head right now. Are you kidding?
I know, right?
That's crazy.
So that's a big one for me personally, because I just saw it all the time, and that was the best. I would watch it just for that, even if I didn't watch the rest of the show. Like, I just loved that intro. Everybody loved that intro, right? But now, where'd it go? So it's kind of remarkable that we remember it the same way. Like, you could probably create it with AI or something, and I'd say, yeah, you got it. Like having a lineup and like draw what we remember. But it's not there. It didn't happen. So this is the Mandela effect at work, where we collectively remember something that is very different than current reality would suggest. And some of these things happen with geography too, like Panama Canal. I remember it, that the canal itself would go sort of between east and west, but now it's lined up north-south for some reason, which is like, what? That's a geographic one that's confusing to me. Like, that doesn't look right at all. So the geography changes are like, wow, that's wild.
So the other one that was really big for me, there's a couple, and this is a geography of the inside the body, where
Okay.
the heart is inside the body. Now, when I grew up, you put your hand over your heart, which was
Yes.
over towards the left or towards my right, your left, you know what I'm talking about. It's over here where my hand would
Yes.
be. So
Yes.
that's where the heart is. But today, the heart is actually in the center of the body. Am I incorrect with that, or am I correct?
It's actually, since I wrote the book, it's moved a little bit more to the left again, not as far as it used to be. I know, it's like, oh my gosh. But this is what happens. This is the danger that this is what I take on when I write a book about the Mandela effect. Can it change again? Yes, because I've heard people say, Cynthia, heart is now, it's not, it's a little bit to the left, but it's not in the center anymore.
I
Like,
mean, I
yeah, it
remember
moved.
a heart
And,
shot in the movies when like when
yes.
the Westerns and stuff were shooting like at their bad guys, but actually when they were practicing, they would always aim for the heart,
Yes.
which would be right here.
Exactly. And now it's a little bit, it's not exactly in the center, it's a little bit in the left, but it's not as
Yeah.
far
No,
to, yeah.
it's not here.
Like, it's been on the, it's one of those that's been on the move, which is very interesting.
I
So,
remember actually like the I remember visuals of like shooting targets that would have
right.
it like it was white, and they would literally have a heart, a red heart over here for people to aim at the heart. I remember seeing those.
I do remember that too. I'm so glad you mentioned that. That's really good. I need to look that up. I'm going to write a note. Check that out.
But the
Yeah,
other
that's
thing
a
that's
great one.
so the but the
That's a
thing
good.
that's fascinating is that there's like things like Mandela and that we get,
Yeah,
but there is
right.
physical proof of our memories out there. So
Right.
one of the things I love to talk about is Ed McMahon. Ed
Yes.
McMahon giving away $1 million for Publishers Clearing House. Okay. I remember Ed McMahon going to some on the commercials, knocking on the door, handing someone a big check for $1 million, and big balloons and a whole camera crew, and everyone going, "Oh my God, oh my God." I remember that
Yes,
clearly. It
I do
never
too.
happened. It never happened, apparently. He never worked for
Wow.
Publishers Clearing House. Why would I know the name Publishers Clearing House? I
Exactly.
like what's the why would I remember that? Why would you remember that name if it didn't have this kind of emotional connection to us? It's not a giant corporation. I don't even know how they stayed in business, which is they're not in business anymore. It was like American, the Ed McMahon did work for a company called American Family something or other,
Yeah, some other thing.
but he
Yeah.
never gave checks away. But now this is where it gets really fun. If you go to YouTube and type up Ed McMahon Mandela Effect, there will be
Yeah.
clips from the 80s where he would guest star on sitcoms. And when he would guest star in sitcoms, what would he do? He would show up at people's doors with a $1 million check and balloons. So
Yeah.
why would he do that if he never did it? Isn't
And
that
even Johnny
amazing?
Carson, it is amazing. And Johnny Carson even had that giant check moment on stage on The Tonight Show. Ed McMahon was his sidekick. So why would he do that if this was not a thing? And yeah, exactly. So all of that evidence indicates clearly that we are remembering something correctly.
So,
Now, critics would say, no, you got tricked. You're just, why would we be tricked by all this? Why would Johnny Carson do that? Why would all these shows, these TV shows like Friends and all these others be mentioning this?
yeah,
Where would they
Friends
get it
mentioned it as
from?
well. Yeah, Friends mentioned it too.
Yeah.
So, but the question is then, what is actually happening in this effect? Because I get like, look, all of us all now agree that in Field of Dreams, if you build it, they will come. That's what I
Right.
remember. It's if you build it, they will come. I asked people, what did they say in Field of Dreams? Oh, if you build it, they will come. No, it's if you build it, he will come. You opened up a
Right.
DVD or you watched the movie, it's if you build it, he will come. But
Right.
anytime anyone referred to that line, which is an extremely famous movie line.
Yes,
And
yes.
people use it in the zeitgeist constantly. If you build it, they will come. If you in business, I think if you build it, they will come. That idea. It's never been if you build it, he will come. So let's say we all agree on this. But then there are these moments like these Ed McMahon video clips that prove our memory. So how can there be two realities happening at the same time? Why is there reminisce? Why is there artifacts of this other reality left over in this reality? How do you explain that?
Well, the artifacts have to do with just it's kind of like what related to all these other things we talked about today, the quantum jumping. We can draw things from other parallel possible timelines. So clearly, we are accessing these obviously very different physical realities. We kind of move through them, move out of them, and there's totally a science to all of it. It seems like the Mandela effect itself is talking with us. It's indicating a little bit about what's going on, that we are the source of it, that we're capable of making these changes, and that there's a lot more to reality than meets the eye. And these are the kind of things that we talk about. We're going to have a conference on this next in November. Every year we do an in-person conference, so people get a chance to come and see it. And we'll have someone who got their PhD in the Mandela effect at this year's 2024 conference, which is pretty exciting. And I'll be talking about the science of the Mandela effect, so sort of the science of the magic of manifesting and all of this, because there's a science to it for sure, and it is showing us little hints about what's going on and who we are, but it opens things up to be this wild, wacky, wonderful world, like you said, of all these possibilities playing out simultaneously, and we're getting a taste of that. We're getting to see it. So now the question the cosmos seems to be asking us is, what would you like to do with it next?
So is that the reason why this is happening now? Because there's no historical, the Greeks weren't talking about, I left my plume here and my toga was not there. This brand of toga was there and this brand of toga wasn't there. I swear I remember that. You don't hear anything like that
No.
in historical documents. This is a very modern phenomenon.
Yes, because we
When
get a
did you?
chance to, we're getting a chance right now to modify our own evolutionary path, and not just through DNA tinkering and the standard method of genetic, whatever they're doing with those CRISPR machines. It's not just that. Something deeper and bigger. We're capable of actually recognizing that through observation alone, we can have an impact on reality itself. And that's what's amazing about this evolutionary moment of great awakening.
So what are some of your favorite Mandela effects? Because there's thousands of them. I mean, there's so many.
There's
The
so
ones that
many.
come, some of the comes to my head is like Jiffy peanut butter. Never existed. It's
Yeah, yeah.
Jif peanut butter. And I could argue that, like, well, there's a Skippy peanut butter and my mind just connected those two. But there's a lot of
I
people who remember Jiffy, the Fruit of the
remember
Loom.
Captain Crunch, the cereal, because it
Of
was
course.
Captain spelled out.
With it.
Now it's just
Oh, was
Cap'n
it?
or something with a little hyphen. It's weird.
I don't remember the weird end. I
No,
do. I
no.
don't remember. I mean, I do remember the weird end. I don't remember the captain. So that's one thing that
Right.
you and I didn't see. We weren't in the same reality there.
Yeah.
But Berenstain Bears, come on, it's Berenstain Bears.
I
It's not
know.
Berenstain Bears. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Jiffy peanut butter. The Fruit of the Loom logo had a cornucopia in
That's
it.
totally out of cornucopia. I remember that too.
Of course, it
And
had a
North and South
cornucopia.
America used to be lined up a lot more, one above the other. Now South America is scooching way over off to the right. It's moving to the east. It's almost created like new time zones, the way it's moving so far. So that one, some geographic changes seem big. And then Gibraltar, I remember the Rock of Gibraltar. That used to be an island, and now it's just part of, it's attached to the land. It's not an
Is it? I thought
island.
it was an
Never.
island. I thought it was an
Because I
island.
remember the Straits of Gibraltar, right? And how can you
Right.
have straits? Right. So how is it possible to have Straits of Gibraltar when Gibraltar is now not an island and it's moved all the way over and attached itself to the land? It doesn't even make sense. It's
Well, do
like
you,
that one's
so
really wacky.
where is the
Never was an
kidney?
island.
So where is the
Yeah,
kidney in your body?
that's a big one for me too. That one now, I remember that if I put my hands on my lower back, I'm putting my hands to protect my kidneys. Well,
Right.
they've moved up. They're not down there vulnerable like they used to be, because that was the area to avoid for a kidney punch. Now they're up,
It's literally called a
much.
kidney punch.
Yes, I know, right? Makes no sense now because they've scooched up in under the rib cage. So that's
The kidneys are
definitely
in the
different.
rib under the rib cage now. You see,
Yeah.
these are things. I mean, it's as we're talking, I'm sure people are having like these moments of like, what is happening? What do you mean the kidney's not there? What are some of your other favorites, like that are just fun, either
Oh.
ads or movies?
Yeah.
I mean, the one Empire Strikes Back. If you build, and if you build, Luke, I
Yeah.
am your father. Luke, I am your father from Empire Strikes Back.
Right, those are big ones.
He never said
Yeah,
that.
right.
It's Luke, I
And
am your
now
father.
I remember life is like a box of chocolates from Forrest Gump, and now it's like life was like I don't know why it's
Life,
past tense.
life, life. No, it's you see,
Was like a box of chocolates.
life's like
What
a
Mama
box of
always
chocolate.
said.
Life's like a box of chocolates.
Yeah.
So I'm saying it in my head
Is.
right now. I'm like, life,
Yeah.
mom always said life's like a box of chocolates. That's the way I remember it. Not
Right.
life was a box. What?
Was.
What?
I know.
No. That's insane. It's
That is
insane.
strange. That was
Which other
crazy.
one? What are some of your favorites?
Well, I think well, a big one for me is kind of weird. It's about his history, the Black Tom explosion, because that was like, if you ask what was the biggest terrorist act and the first terrorist, huge terrorist act on American soil, I wouldn't say anything about Black Tom explosion. Maybe I just didn't learn it is what I would, qualify it as. But this happened in 1916 in the summer. And it was a munitions explosion right around the time of World War I. And it, in the process of the explosion, it damaged the Statue of Liberty. I don't remember the Statue of Liberty getting damaged. And that ties in with the Statue of Liberty and people remembering you used to be able to go up into the arm and look
Yes.
around in the torch.
Yes.
Yeah, well,
Yes.
now apparently that can't have happened because the Black Tom explosion thing happened and the Statue of Liberty got damaged. It's like, wait a
Wait a
minute.
minute, wait a minute. In Ghostbusters 2, they go into the arm of the Statue of Liberty and are shooting their whatevers from the fire, from the torch. So you're telling me
Yeah.
you can't go into the torch, technically?
And now it's true that you can't. I don't know what the date is. These things sometimes move. Like
Because that
sometimes
was
people watch.
1988. I think it was like
Right.
88,
80s.
89 when
Yeah.
that's
Right.
when Ghostbusters 2 happened. But
Right.
it's in the storyline that they're walking up the Statue of Liberty and they walked into that. Like,
Right. That's a great memory that you have for the movie. Love your movie memory. So
well,
cool.
I have a
Very
lot of
visual.
I have a lot of useless information in my head. A lot of
Love
movie trivia.
Ghostbusters. It was so much
Ghostbusters
fun.
2. So
Yeah, but
but
now,
that's
now
weird.
you
Yeah.
can't go. Now I don't remember what year they stopped allowing people into the torch, but
But
because
you could at
now
one
they say it's
point,
dangerous.
but you could
Maybe
at one point.
so. I don't remember exactly when that changed. That's what gets confusing about some of these changes. It's like, well, what year did that happen? And I don't remember. But the thing that's strange for me is this whole Black Tom explosion. I don't remember that at all.
I've never heard of it. I've never even heard of that in my
Thank
life.
you.
I've never
Thank you.
heard of that ever in my life in any history class. And I'm a history buff. Never heard of
Okay.
it. I was at the Statue of Liberty
So it should have
and
come up. People should have mentioned it. This is where the damage occurred.
no one ever mentioned it on the tour. No one mentioned it in the museum. It's not talked about.
This is
I
the
don't
repair
remember
job
any.
we did when the munitions exploded. Nothing like
That
that.
would be something that would be talked about
Would think
in
so.
I would think that's something we'd be talked about. Oh my God. Cynthia, we could keep going down this road for another hour or two just on this the different cool Mandela effects. Anyone interested in this, just go type in Mandela effect examples on YouTube. And just sit back, relax, and your head's going to explode. I've fallen down a few of those rabbit holes, and it's just like, what? That's not there? What? That's changed. What? What's going on here? It's fascinating. It's fascinating. I'm going to ask you a few questions, ask all my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
It's just living a life that has few regrets. There are always going to be some, but just knowing that I'm living up to my highest potential, the how good can it get life, that I'm doing my best job at that.
Now, this is an interesting question for you. If you had a chance to go back in time and speak to little Cynthia, what advice would you give her?
Be yourself, don't be too shy. Don't worry about being weird. Weirdness will be cool later.
How do you define God or source?
Just so much love. It feels like love is the first word that comes to mind. Love, peace, harmony, and wisdom. It's just the deep sense of enlightenment and joy that comes from the bliss and the reverence. It's hard to just find one word for it. Love is if it had one word.
And my next question, what is love?
That's the toughest one of all. It's the greatest feeling. It's so much more than a feeling. It feels like an interdimensional expansion. It feels like the path to enlightenment itself, path to wisdom. It's the light to follow. It's the joy that is, and it's where we all come from.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
To remember and rediscover, you know, what matters most and what we care about, and to connect, to really deeply connect with everything and everyone we most love.
And where can people find out more about you, the amazing work you're doing, and pick up a copy of The Mandela Effect and Its Society?
Well, my website is a good place to start, realityshifters.com. And currently that book, Mandela Effect and Its Society, and my other books are available through Amazon and also Barnes and Noble and online and other places. So that book currently has the ebook, the paperback, and a hardcover edition. And I'll be working on the audiobook hopefully soon.
I don't, you see, in my reality, I don't remember a Barnes and Noble. I didn't even know that it ever existed. I'm
Not
joking. I'm
kidding.
joking. I'm joking. I'm joking. I'm joking. I'm joking. I'm joking. No, Cynthia, do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Just keep asking questions that you most want to live the answer to. And if you catch yourself saying things you don't want to live the answer to, just cancel it out. Add in, how good can it get? It'll usually bring things back on an upward trajectory.
Cynthia, it's been such a pleasure. I always love talking to you and going down these ridiculously deep rabbit holes that we do. Hopefully everyone who's been watching's head's not completely fried after this conversation. But I appreciate you and everything you're doing to awaken the planet. So thank you again for coming on the show.
Thank you, Alex. Love you so much.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey. And don't forget to subscribe.